Yenge ba yenge. In Congo, we say mbote. Mbote means hello.
Mbote. Yenge, mbote. Yenge.
Yenge. And then we say ingeta. Ingeta means, you know, we shall overcome. We shall definitely overcome.
Ingete. We definitely ingeta. Will overcome. Ingeta.
Ingeta. Ingeta. My name is Avi. I'm your brother. I love you all so much. Those are watching us today. It's an honor to be on this sessionist show. I'm a big fan of the panel. I love Brother Germans. I love Dr. Abu. Absolutely. I miss Sister Sheila is not here. I wish she was here as well.
She's coming. She's got to be joining
you're watching us. It's an honor to have you all coming here. My name is Avi. I'm from Zola Bantu. It's a community of love, purity, and justice in Congo. We say Zolanga Angulendo. Takumpambu Nzinga. It means love, purity, and justice. Because if you go to Egypt, you notice that the Egyptians built the pyramids in a triangular sign. It was symbolic. It was the three pillars of spirituality, which is love, purity, and justice. Love are the priests, purity are the scientists, and then justice are the judges, basically the politicians. So they balanced the entire pyramid into the priests, the scientists, and the governors. So the pyramid was like this because the priests were on top. They were connecting the entire society to the ancestors, and then the scientists were the ones that was getting the information from the ancestors to design the environment in the perfect way, and the judges were basically the ones that was governing the society. So the scientists could not do anything without getting permission from the priest, and the governor would not do anything without getting permission from the priest. You know, that is why in Egypt the priests, which were mostly women, by the way, because women were the ones who were the priests. They were the ones that was giving the direction to the judges and to the scientists to develop a society. So in Egypt, all our pharaohs only married the daughter of the priest because it was a law in Egypt, in Kemet, for the pharaoh to marry the daughter of the priest to make sure that him as a judge, as a governor, to govern the society in the right way. This is why we had such an elevated kingdom in Egypt, because we had this pyramid of Nsakumpambu Nzinga that guided the entire civilization. But because after some time we began to intermarry with different nations, the Babylonians and the Assyrians, people began to come to Kemet and Egypt, and we began to adopt different lifestyles, and then we began also to lose our values. You know, if you study about Pharaoh Kenatu, today they call him Akhenaton. His name was Pharaoh Akhenatu, you know, and he was the last one that was able to maintain this pyramid structure. But because of his mistake of marrying a princess of Babylon that became his wife, that gave him two daughters that you know, Nefertiti, and the other younger sister who later on married the prince of Babylon that came to invade Egypt, this is how our Nsakumpambu Nzinga fell. And the Greeks came and invaded our nations of Egypt, and we were forced to run away into Southern Africa. In this journey that the Bible speaks about, the exile led by Moshe Massa, our leader, and we spread across the entire continent of Africa. And this is where our pain began. We ran in an exodus of over 1,000 years. They claimed to say when they came to Africa, they found us with no clothes. But we were running up and down for 1,000 years of exile. We lost our clothes. We lost knowledge. Knowledge began to be transmitted orderly because we lost our books. A black man wrote. We had the first universities in Kush, in Egypt. But we lost this because of the exile. We're being killed everywhere, my dear brothers and sisters. We came to appear in the heart of Africa 690 AD, after 900 years of being chased around and being killed everywhere, the Bantu people, you and me, the brothers and sisters in the Haiti, all of us in the Caribbean, in Jamaica. This is our story. We began to rebuild our kingdom slowly in 690 AD, but unfortunately, you know the story. In the 14th century, the Portuguese explorer Diego Cao landed in the heart of Africa. They tell us that they came to look for resources and land, but they knew our story in the text, that after we left Egypt, we ran to the south of Africa. And they came and colonized us They enslaved us for over 98 years, and they put us into colonization for over 500 years. This is our story. So it's because we lost these principles of Ubuntu. African people are people that vibrate in Ubuntu. So what does Ubuntu mean? When we speak about spirituality, I know we're going to dive into resources, but you need to understand this, the foundation, to be able to understand why are we so poor. That's why I'm trying to align this story for you. We lost Ubuntu. What does Ubuntu mean? Living from the inside out. You know, when you are a Western person, you live from the outward in. It's what you do outside that gives you the satisfaction that you are elevated before the highest. But Ubuntu people are people that live from the inward out. Kimuntu. I'll give you a simple analogy. A human being is like a car and a driver. You know, the body that we wear, it is just matter. The energy lives inside. Okay, it is the driver of the car. So the energy requires the car to function. Many of you know how to drive. If you have a car, you need to put the fuel. You need to put the requirements that the car needs to function for you. So as a human being, you need food, you need shelter, you need everything that feeds your physical body to allow your spirit, your moon to excel in this particular universe. So this is just a brief for you to understand Ubuntu and to understand Kimuntu. Now the question we're trying to ask is, why is Africa resource rich, but yet we are poor? It's because the primary problem is we Africans. We are to blame. We are the primary problem. The second problem is the Western people. And now we have the Eastern people, the Chinese as well. But why do we say we as Africans are the ones that are to blame for our problems? Because Africans are divided into three categories. We have 1.3 billion Africans, over 140 million Africans in the diaspora. All of these Africans can be divided into three categories. We have the Afrikaners, C-O-O-N-S. We have the Afrikaans, C-A-N-T. And we have the African, C-A-N, like Sister Shanice, Dr. Abu, the Afrikaans. But unfortunately, of the 1.3 billion Africans that we have in Africa, the Afrikaans are only 5%. Only 5%. The Afrikaans are 80%. And then the African are only 15%. And let's do the maths. 5%, 65 million Africans, Afrikaans. 15%, 195 million African, like Sister Shanice over here, Dr. Jammers. And then the remaining 80% are Afrikaans. But who are Afrikaans? Afrikaans are rich. They have so much money. They're enjoying life. They work for the oppressors. They have signed treaties with the oppressors to destroy Africans. They make sure that Africa remains as a reservoir of primary materials. Most of them are politicians, rich businessmen and women, celebrities, Western educated intellectuals in the paradigm of the West. They have a degree in Cambridge, Harvard, very, very intellectual people working for our oppressors. So all these categories of Afrikaans, they control the entire economic institutions of Africa under the supervision of our enemies. But they only make 5% of Africans. Now, second category, the Afrikaans, C-A-N-T. They are poor, uneducated, ignorant, locked in dogmas and precepts, in mental prisons of religion. They believe in a savior in the sky. They believe in a man that died for them on the cross. Allahu Akbar. They can jump into the mall, blast themselves, waiting for 72 virgins in heaven. They are kept in propaganda, in media destruction. They easily vote for Afrikaans. Afrikaans love Afrikaans. Afrikaans, when you bring them money, they will vote for you because they are asleep. And finally, we have the last category, which is the Afrikaans, like Sister Shanice and you who's watching, who understand the issues of Africa, who's making an effort to change Africa. But the Afrikaans are hated by Afrikaans. Afrikaans don't like us. Afrikaans like to kill Afrikaans. Patrice Lumumba was killed by an Afrikaan. The Masangar was killed by an African. Steve Biko was killed by an African. Magufuli was killed by an African under the influence of the enemies. But unfortunately, also within the Africans, we also have our own faults. We don't like to unite. We don't like to come together. We are Africans, yes. We don't like to come together. We don't like to unite. So these are the three categories of Africans. Judge for yourself, where are you? Are you in the African? Mr. President, are you in the African? Are you an African or are you an African? This is the problem why Africa is so rich but poor. Why? Because the Africans control the entire economy of Africa, directed by the West, directed by the Americans, directed by the Europeans, directed by the Canadians, directed by the New Zealand, directed by the Australians, and now China is part of the cake. And then you have the Africans. The Africans have no choice because the Africans, they are mentally extravated. They're in dogmas and precepts. Many of them are religious. They fast 40 days a night, but they're Africans. They can't do anything. But the Africans that you and I, we are very few trying to wake up the Africans. So the only way we can be able to make Africa rich in resources is if you and I as Africans can wake up the Africans. The Africans are only 80%. A large number of Africans, 800 million Africans. If you and I, Africans, wake up the conscience of the Africans, then we can overthrow the Africans. I hear people say, Madam Shanice just said, speak to the African governments. But African governments are Africans. They will never sit on the table with you and discuss with you on anything because an African, one of all, spiritually, he has sold his soul to the devil. He will never work with you. And Africans believe that life is YOLO. We only live once. Make it now. But Africans believe that life goes on. Just like you plant a seed in the ground, you come back. So I don't need to have 5 cars and 10 houses. No. I need to build a business for my family because I know if I die 4 generations down, I'm back. I inherit my own proper production. But if you're an African, you think life ends right here. So my dear brothers and sisters, we as Africans, we need to wake up the African or else we'll continue to be poor and continue to be the reservoir of primary materials. We have nothing to do with the Africans. Africans can never change. You never take your project to the governor or the politician to hear you out. He will never do anything for you. Our only hope are the Africans, the 80%. Those that are going to church, believing in a savior in the sky. Those that are going to in religious. Those that are uneducated. Those that like to spend hours watching TV, media, being brainwashed. Those are the targets. Those are basically our target. And make sure, mind you, if you do not wake up the Africans, the West, they have a $50 billion industry to keep the Africans as Africans. The TV programming keeps the Africans as Africans. So my dear brothers and sisters, this is what I have to say for now, for you to understand why we as Africans, no matter how hard we work, no matter how hard we talk. And lastly, the Africans like to talk. We like having Zoom meetings. We are always on stream yet. We love talking and talking, but less of action. So I bless you and I love you all so much. It's an honor to be here and share this small message that I had for you. Sister Shanice, thank you.